Good morning. Let me just tell you a quick incident. The other day, I met with Padma Vibhushan Dr. Vijay Kelkar, which I'm sure many of you have heard and know him well. He's been a great mentor for us, was on the board of TCS for a while. So I'd gone to meet him, and he asked me a very interesting question. He said, "Dare, you guys are doing phenomenally well, you know, as a company, but tell me one thing which is very unique about your company, TCS. And I said, "Sir, you have seen many customers and you have been in a better position than I have been, so why don't you tell me what is your understanding of TCS?" And he said something very interesting, and it resonated very strongly, and it probably, if you ask anybody in the TCS leadership, that is the one thing they will say. And he said, "Customer centricity." He said, "I have never seen an organization so customer centric." And the reason I bring this up is a very interesting point over here is that we are talking about industry-academia partnership in context of internships, but for whom? We're talking about students. Effectively, they are our customers in some sense. And when I look at this room, we don't have the customer in the room. Okay, so I just wanted to reflect upon that entire incident was sort of at the back of my mind, and I was thinking that how do we work as an organization? We've always put the customer at the center of everything that we do. And I think all of us as industries representing different organizations have also done that. I think it's a very important element in the change that we are going through. We have to put the customer at the center of everything that we do. And that's how I'm going to start off. I wanted to give a perspective from a point of view of a customer and what is really changing in the industry so that we are able to relate to what are the type of problems we are solving, what are the type of issues are being faced. And I'll relate that to, you know, you mentioned about Dr. Mashelkar, and Dr. Mashelkar always says this one very interesting thing: we're creating left brain engineers. He said, he always tells me, "Are, empathy bhaije. You need to have that empathy from a customer point of view to understand what problem is there." And this is one thing he says, that I need whole brain engineers for the next world, okay? And he says, how do you bring in that right brain element into the engineer so that they have the empathy towards what problems are there? But before understanding what those problems are, let me tell you about the type of solutions we are creating so that you are able to relate to how is industry changing and what are the type of things that have been done in the industry. So I've taken some examples, and these are examples across the globe. These are solutions that my colleagues have been building for different industries. And I thought I should give you this perspective about the type of problems and type of opportunities we are solving. So this image is of a nuclear power plant. This is in a Mitsubishi plant in Japan. And what we have done is we have created a digital twin of this nuclear power plant. Right in India, there are people who are monitoring different parameters, and I'm sure, you know, it's great that Dr. Bajaj got everybody to introduce themselves. I think it was a great learning for us to see the diverse set of people, and I heard people who are in the field of electronics, in the field of, in the DRDO setup. There's a lot of interesting things being done in remote monitoring and surveillance of setups like this by creating digital twins. This is one such example. I heard friends from Cummins over here. This is one of the work that we've been doing for Cummins internationally. Cummins, I've been having a long association with Cummins for almost 20 years. I've visited Cummins in the US a couple of times, spent time at their aftermarket in Memphis. An engine manufacturer started looking at how they can actually be in the logistics end-to-end supply chain and servitization of the engine itself. So it's not about just selling an engine, but a complete diagnostics of that engine and that entire movement of that truck from location A to location B. And this is a very, very interesting truck. This actually truck transports medicines. And you need to have a complete monitoring of what is the type of temperature control and various things which are there on that truck, completely handled by devices and by communication. These are the type of problems we are working on. Slightly a different industry, it's the steel industry. This is our own business, Tata Steel industry. And one of the things which I have been faced with many a times when I go and talk to heavy industries or industries which have a significant amount of hazardous environments, the one thing that I get asked question is, do you have any solutions related to safety? Any organization, I was with Boeing 3 weeks back, and the only discussion I had with one of their executives was around safety. And there was no need to relate to why that safety was such a big concern. I spent time with Jamshedpur, and you talk to any of the senior executives in Tata Steel, the one thing they will talk about is, do you have solutions related to safety? Okay, it's safety about the people who are there, the type of people are blue-collared workers, they just don't have a sense of what could potentially come up. And there are regulations which are coming up which are looking at real-time monitoring of safety. Okay, I have one of our colleagues, Dr. Mani, who is also ex-DRDO, and he was talking about the safety monitoring that they need to do when they are actually having people, the armed forces in combat, and the type of monitoring that they do. So again, problems related to surveillance which are being done. Healthcare, another big area for us. Probably see a toy over there. The lady is interacting with a cat. That's actually not a cat, that's actually a toy. And it has various sensors on it. It's actually real-time monitoring what all is happening in the ecosystem of that old patient. And it's a very interesting project that we are doing in Singapore with the government. It's a CSR program that we are doing, where we are looking at how do we look at patient care, especially for elders, and using technology and solving some of these aspects of having not having to have an attendant nearby, but being able to detect various things which are happening. Some very interesting type of solutions being created. I'm sure many of you have gone to different airports and you'll see wheelchairs being moved around. And it happens in hospitals also. So very interestingly, we came across this particular problem where one of the airlines said that we spend hundreds of millions in managing wheelchairs in the airport, and we just don't have a track of how many wheelchairs, what is the type of experience, who they just get a bill at the end of the month because they are outsourcing this entire operations. And we were doing some very interesting work in a hospital where there was wheelchair management we had completely automated using digital technologies. We just lifted that solution and brought it into the airline industry. And today, the entire wheelchair operations can be managed on an iPad by tracking where are the wheelchairs, where are the attendants, who is getting a bad experience, and all of that stuff gets done in a completely digital manner. The interesting thing was, we actually, as a technologist, we have always sat in an office and actually gone and done studies of different types of problems. On site, we'll go and meet some people. We actually did the study of this entire operations in JFK Terminal 5. So just to give you a sense of the type of changes that we as an industry and we as an organization are going through, the type of solutions as we create them. This is a medical equipment manufacturer. Again, a significant amount of concern as regards the predictive nature of failure prediction. What could fail in an equipment like this? So a lot of analytics goes into predictive maintenance of these equipments. I'm sure financial services is a big industry. We've spent a lot of time and money in looking at cybersecurity as a core area. A lot of interesting solutions being developed in this area. The reason to highlight a lot of these things is that the nature and the complications or the complexities which are there in different types of industries is growing, and we are getting to work on some of these problems. One of the most neglected areas, if I would say, as far as Indian education or Indian engineering education is concerned, is the field of farming and agriculture. If there's 50% of the nation depends, the economy depends on agriculture, how many of our engineering projects are targeted towards this industry? And we've been working on this particular area. We have a very interesting program. It started off as a CSR program and later evolved into a digital farming initiative. I have been closely associated with some interesting work that we are doing. But again, some very interesting opportunities and solutions being created in the digital farming area that we are working on. We've created a digital nerve center for cancer patients. This is something which came up as a very interesting data point. So Tata Group runs two big hospitals, one in Mumbai and one in Calcutta, and there are a few others which through the trust and Mr. Tata getting set up at different locations. So one of the things that we noticed was we didn't necessarily have good amount of data about the patients and what type of issues are they facing. And you would be surprised when we actually started analyzing and looking at the data, there is a rural center, there is a regional center, and then you could potentially have the centers like the Tata Memorial Hospital, which is like a three-stage escalation. A patient, just imagine a patient, an old lady, who goes to the regional center for treatment, and she's been detected for something, she's not keeping well, so she goes there. And they tell her, look, for this particular thing, you need to get these tests done. And these tests have to be done at the rural center, so you cannot come to us without these tests. So she goes back. In going from one place to another and going back, she spent almost 2,000, 3,000 rupees. And she just cannot afford to take that second trip back, and she escalates on the cancer and then potentially dies, right? So we decided to look at this particular problem and just create a nerve center which is sort of a connect point between doctors or people in the healthcare and the patients directly and enable them to ensure that they get the right guidance so that they can get the treatment at the right levels accordingly. So this is a very interesting initiative where technology is playing a very interesting role. So given this, we came up with a very interesting framework. We call it as our Business 4.0 framework, and we've been driving this as a theme, as a thought leadership framework, and primarily looking at what is changing in the industry. Obviously, in the technology dimension, there is significant amount of change. There's a lot of automation. Agile is becoming a practice that everybody follows. Again, that's one point which I discussed with Dr. Shevgaonkar also, is that how much agile are we in the academia on changing certain things? So if industry is agile, is academia agile? Automation, intelligence. Very interesting, why is intelligence important is to understand insights about the students itself. Students come with different backgrounds, different type of skills. Do we have the data around the people or the products that we are creating? And on cloud, so how are we leveraging cloud and how are we using technology in a very effective manner by means of leveraging all of these solutions which are available. At the same time, let's look at it from a business point of view. What is it really requiring from a point of view of creating those solutions? So one most important thing which we look at is when you say customer centricity, the segment of one, that is every customer or every student is very special, right? How are we creating a solution for that individual at that level of mass customization that you can potentially do is the very critical element of this particular framework as to what is the experience can you give, what is the type of customization you can provide to that particular customer that you are looking at. And obviously the other element which is very important that we are highlighting is leveraging of the ecosystem. We've seen that, just look at across this room itself, I was quite amazed at the type of diverse set of expertise that is there in this setup. And we're missing still quite a few. Sir mentioned about Maratha Chamber of Commerce, and we were trying to get Prashant Girbane, who was the director, but he's having some other commitments. But getting industry forums into this mix is very important. Getting the small and medium businesses or the unorganized sector is also important. Getting people from agriculture is also important. So are we leveraging the ecosystem which is there to really look at the talent pool that we are creating and making an impact? So what I thought was, while with this is important, I just wanted to give a feel of, since the question I am posing to the academia is that how fast are you changing? I just wanted to give you a feel of how fast we have changed, okay? So over 2 years, we had a significant amount of change. Our CEO became the chairman of the Tata Group. And since then, in the last 24 months, we have pretty much reorganized the entire organization. A 20 billion organization going through a change at that scale is unheard of. Okay? 200 top leaders, and I'm part of that top leadership team, pretty much everybody has gone through a role change in the last 2 years. We have, in that same time period, crossed 100 billion in market capitalization, which is 40% as compared to what was there the previous year. So the important thing is that, is industry changing as fast? And the answer is yes. industry is changing probably much faster than what you would even imagine, because we just don't have a choice. It is a matter of survival. It is a matter of what is happening in the industry and in the businesses. We just don't have a choice. In my business, and I've just put up a few areas which are there, and I'm sure many of my friends from the industry can relate to this. You go anywhere in any company, and you just say you are working on data and analytics. There is no dearth of demand. For me, I just don't have a problem of demand. The demand is just there. I have to just go and interact, and I will get business for my business. That's the level of demand which is there. And that's the type of opportunity and the potential which is there in the industry. So I just wanted to highlight to you that there is tremendous amount of demand in the industry for various of these technologies, various of these solutions which are there. It's important for us to understand and be able to relate to what that demand is and what can potentially be done. So what have we been doing? So I'll give a feel of, Preeti madam told me that I should also tell what we are doing as an organization. What are we doing along with IEEE? I wanted to cover some of these things. We started taking a look at this about 3 or 4 years back when we said that the entire digital era is coming in. There was a lot of talk about jobs getting lost, people not necessarily being rightly skilled and things like that. And we said, let's do something about it. So this is one thing which we have been working on the digital skilling. And I'll talk about what we are doing specifically along with different partners. So this is something which we announced at the World Economic Forum. Within the TCS organization itself, we are about a 425,000 organization. About 350,000 people have actually gone through a complete upskilling in the last 3 to 4 years. So significant amount of work being done on skilling within the organization. About a year and a half back, our CEO actually came and challenged us, said that, you guys are asking a lot of things from academia. What are you guys doing? Okay. So we actually put together this program called Computer Science and Business Systems, CSBS as it is called. About a year back, we were involving a lot of people from academia. We involved Professor Sahasrabuddhe, and we've actually launched this academic year with three pilot institutes, including Bharatiya Vidyapit in Pune, and one college in Calcutta and one in Coimbatore. And there is the core to this particular program is internship. Okay, there are at least three interventions where, and it has both the aspects. So the points that you mentioned, sir, about industry participating in teaching, as well as students and faculty coming and spending time in internship. So very good program. And I remember I went to Dr. Mashelkar, and he had just had a meeting with Mr. Zavdekar, and he was telling her, this is what he told me. And I said, sir, this is what we have actually created. And the next thing which he did is send it to me. The mail went to Mr. Zavdekar. They got us connected with Professor Sahasrabuddhe. In about a month's time, we actually got this approved and signed off for implementation. The important point is that I think there is a lot of participation from industry, and I've talked to many of my colleagues and friends in other industries as well. They are more than happy to contribute on coming up with curriculum, coming up with things, and this is not compromising anything on the fundamentals. So we had very significant contribution from academia. So I actually had organized a workshop of about 20 heads of different institutions in Pune itself to ensure that we are not looking at being very selfish, and we are creating a very sustainable model for engaging and creating these new curriculums. So this is something very interesting that we've created. So the other thing is we talked about internships and we talked about innovation. Very interesting program that we have started in Nasik. This is along with MIT. So many of you have probably heard about Kumbh Mela, and you must have heard about the word hackathon. So you created a very interesting program called Kumbathon. And that was the idea which started off, saying that let's look at the problems which happen when a Kumbh Mela happens. Very much of a congregation of almost 10 million people at a very short time. Different types of problems, healthcare related problem, traffic related problem, water related problems, safety related problems. And we created this center, which is called the Digital Impact Square, where people would actually come together, experts from different areas, and solve the problems which are very much related to that particular event. And then we actually made this into a permanent establishment. So Digital Impact Square now has internships where students come in. We have an annual program where we have selection. It's a 6 months internships that they do, and there is involvement from experts from different colleges in Nasik. MIT is involved. Some of the folks from my unit are also participating in this setup, and good opportunity for us to actually incubate and create new solutions. The good thing about this is the IP that is generated in the Digital Impact Square is of the innovator. You know, we have no right on that IP at all as an organization. We're completely supporting this effort, but that's the type of thing that we've been able to do. Something completely different. We did some very interesting experiment in the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and my team was very closely involved. Those of you who are not familiar with Saudi Arabia, women were not even allowed to drive till about 9 months back, okay? And we actually created an all-women center where we would have employment for women in the center. When I was heading that place, we were close to about 1,000 women working at that particular center. Very high on aspiration, very high on wanting what they can show to the crowd. And we had the opportunity of hosting Prime Minister Modi at this particular location. And it was a very proud moment for us, because to try something which is very unique and very different and probably one of the most difficult projects that we have ever done. But that's the type of dare, that's the type of things that which are required for organizations to take up and drive this. Also looking at innovation centers, this is something you rightly said that we have seen a very good model in the US where this is an innovation center which was bidded out by many companies. So this is in Cornell Tech, which happens to be the alma mater for Mr. Ratan Tata. And we bid for this, and we have a Tata Innovation Center in the New York campus of Cornell Tech. And we have many of our customers and many of my colleagues actually part of various innovation labs which are there inside this particular innovation center. You know, one of the things, I was there at the inauguration, I told that, you know, we should ideally have many more such innovation centers in India. And there are, actually, we have a center in IIT Bombay. We've just created one in IIIT Hyderabad. So we've been investing in some of these. But I think it's important for industry to actually look at creating these centers which will enable them to play a role in IP creation and innovation. Something that I'm doing as part of the IEEE Pune section. So Mr. Kohli, who was the first founder of TCS and the first director, he actually gave us this challenge, saying that you guys are doing a lot of things for customers, but you're not doing anything for agriculture. So it was about a couple of years back. I came back, and you know, Jagdish Chaudhary, who is here, you know, he's part of the Execom for IEEE, and there were a few others. And I just shared with them a very emotional moment for all of us in saying that, look, a person who is 93 years old, probably the father of the Indian IT industry, still regrets that we couldn't do something for our country, and agriculture is very neglected. And that was the seed for an idea which actually has blossomed up into a phenomenal project. And Jagdish is here throughout the day, so you should hear about this. We've created a very fantastic ecosystem. A very interesting data point for you. The oldest agriculture college and the third oldest engineering college are separated by 1 kilometer. But they never had an opportunity to collaborate. Through this initiative, we have created that collaborative ecosystem. There are 6 engineering colleges. There are 2 biotech firms, TCS, Bau Institute, Agriculture College, 2 NGOs. They're all working together. What we have done is we have created labs in 6 engineering colleges called Affordable Agriculture Labs. And we are seeing a lot of interesting developments because of this. You go across in any engineering college, you'll find every alternate faculty member will have a background on agriculture. You'll find that through this Affordable Agriculture Lab, there is a degree of ownership of a problem, a degree of breaking down of walls. So there are electrical engineers working with computer science, working with electronics engineers, working with mechanical engineers to solve problems. So we're trying to see how we can actually make that difference. And most important, you know, when we look at all the news items and things like that, there's a lot of sympathy for the farmers. What we have done is shifted that sympathy to empathy. And I think that if you really look at internship and if you look at some of these possibilities, it is tremendous. So Mr. Rahul Karad was there when we inaugurated the lab. And one of the things he was telling me is they have created a rural immersion program. For 2 weeks or 1 week, the student has to go and spend in a rural location understand what's really happening, and then come back to try and look at what type of solutions they can create. We were very impressed with the type of solutions the kids are creating, but most important, I have about 300 students and faculty members who are now very well versed with what type of problems are being faced by the farmers of India. We are creating two demo farms along with the NGOs in Marathwada district, and then we are looking at how the demo farms can potentially be showcasing the innovations that these affordable agriculture labs are creating. Another guidance from Dr. Mashelkar, he said, he uses this thing very often, he says STEM to STEAM. How do you bring in empathy in the engineering students or any student? He said, we always focus on STEM, which is science, technology, engineering, and maths, and we need to bring in arts into this. How do you bring in the arts element into the engineering student? And we've started working on this. Dr. Mani, who is the former director of DIIT, he is leading this effort, and we are making some progress just about in the infancy stage around this. The third initiative that we are running is around the Pune city, the smart city project, and we are looking at the data which is coming out of the smart city initiative. So we have actually deputed a chief data officer from TCS through the Tata Trust as working along with the PMC commissioner to look at all the data that is being collected and the data which is being classified as open data for different types of areas. And we run these data hackathons to primarily understand what are the type of solutions can be created with the data which is existing in the city of Pune. So I'll give you one more very interesting example. You may be surprised, you may be hearing about census. And the first thing when you say about census, you think about census of people. There's a tree census which the city of Pune does. Every few years, there is a census of the trees, and you might have seen some labels on the trees. So she actually came up with this idea of putting that problem, saying that here is the census data of the trees. What can the students of engineering come up with as ideas? And they came up with brilliant ideas. They actually mapped the entire set of trees. They looked at the code. They put the geospatial map, showed the entire visualization of the trees on the city of Pune. And they showed how the time series worked. How did the trees deplete over a period of time? It was an amazing exercise. And then my teams, which were involved, they started looking at is, are there business opportunities with this data? And they came up with one very interesting correlation, saying that this particular region, when you look at the pollution data and the depletion of trees, is the highest of risk from a respiratory illness point of view. Can you look at healthcare organizations looking at targeting those areas from a respiratory treatment point of view? Another very interesting data point, it didn't come up in the hackathon, but I was in Melbourne and I was interacting with one of the water companies. And I asked him about what do you do with tree census data. So it's very important for us to look at groundwater and how do you look at groundwater improvement. So we do tree plantation drives, and I'm sure many of you out here would have gone and done tree plantation drive. But is that data driven? Are you really looking at the data? Are you looking at the patterns which are there, which are actually useful to decide, look, this is an area where we can potentially do tree plantation? Those are the type of opportunities which are there, and this data is all available. You know, it's government sites have the largest amount of data sets. And you would be actually surprised, you know, when I went to that affordable agriculture lab, I was asking, they were telling me about the innovations that they were doing. And I kept on asking them, where did you get this data? And they knew where the data was. They knew this particular site, they had downloaded it from that site, they were showing me the patterns which they had from that. So don't underestimate your customer. Your customer today is much more intelligent than what you would imagine that customer to be. Okay? And I was very impressed with this particular aspect that we have to then shift ourselves from being teachers and industry to being facilitators and potentially looking at learning from a new set which is coming in into the organization. So when I look at these type of interactions that I have, it's a big learning. Many a times I'm not able to attend, but whenever my colleagues attend these workshops, I meet with them and try to understand, hey, what are the interesting things that these things are being done. Shifting over from what is happening in the city of Pune, a very interesting program, which is run by a close friend of mine, Ruchi Mathur. She runs this program, which is called Pune, or a setup called Pune City Connect. And they run digital literacy. So there are different pockets within Pune which are focus areas for them. And they look at digital literacy as a clear driver. So it's not just pure literacy, but looking at digital literacy. How do you enable publics or the government services through the digital channel for the people? You would be actually amazed. The percentage of digital literacy in a city like Pune, you can take a guess. Okay? It is single digits. Yeah, same reaction from me, first time when I heard it. Because we think that everybody is using a mobile phone. They are digitally literate. They can do a WhatsApp and my maid is using a WhatsApp and somebody else. But they don't use the true power of digital services. We talk about digital India, but are they true citizens of digital India? Answer is no. Can they pay their bills? Can they do their payments? Can they look at downloading something which is useful for them from a reference point of view? That's a gap. The other thing which was very interesting, and I spent some time with them, we are on the board and we are helping them on various initiatives. You know, there are different institutes. So Symbiosis, for example, has a program where they actually have students deputed into this program, and they go and enable and facilitate this. That's a great experience. So I was interacting with some of these students and said, if I had done this type of an internship in an organization vis-a-vis what I'm doing over here, I wouldn't have got this type of an experience. And I feel that when we look at internships, don't necessarily limit yourself to an industry. You look at what else is there around you. What actually opened my eye was, I looked at just my ward. I stay now in Pune. And when we go in a car and when we walk around, we always look up. We only see the big buildings. We see the bungalows and we see this high-rise buildings. We completely miss the bottom of the pyramid. And I was amazed at the data points which were there with them about where are these localities where there is a highest concentration of their target customers, which are the people that they were looking at. It was a set which was just across. I just couldn't see them because I always looked up. The point I'm making is that there is a lot of opportunity when we look down and see at a grassroots level what are the type of opportunities. Another interesting program, and I would love if you guys can also spend time and go and see this place. This is in Lavale, an academy called Avsara Academy. It's been set up by a very renowned economist from Goldman Sachs. She actually left her job, moved to India, and set up this academy. It is for girl child only. It is run with IB curriculum. And the focus is not on just educating a girl child. The focus is on building leadership qualities in the girl child. It's about 4 years since this program has been running. And I've been very closely associated with them. We've been involved in funding and setting up one of their buildings. They have about 7 buildings. So Godrej, Hexaware, and a few others have also participated in funding the entire setup. But the interesting thing is that these girls have taken up this opportunity in a significant manner. And the reason I'm highlighting this is the focus on girl-child education is a phenomenal transformation that India is going through. When I have my leadership development program and I have very specific program for women leaders, one of the things which I tell them, I put up this chart and I put up some of the girl-child education programs which are there, and also the toilet program, and I'll come back to that a little later, is that the number of women who will get into the workforce is going to significantly increase in the next 5 to 10 years. We actually ran the toilet program for almost a year. So we didn't just give 100 crore rupees, which Chandra announced immediately after the announcement by Prime Minister on Red Fort. We announced we will spend 100 crores on the toilet program. We ran that program. We didn't give the money. We had a program manager who ensured that and we collected a lot of data points on what's really happening. And there is a nice video, if you may go to YouTube and just check Priya as a name and toilet program or whatever, Swachh Bharat program. We actually collected data on what was the school dropout rate change after implementation of a toilet in a rural area. The dropout rate pretty much flipped. There was 85% dropout rate, it went down to 15%. That is a big indicator for us to look at that population of the girl child which is coming into the mainstream. Are we doing enough to address the needs? And the work that Rupa is doing is phenomenal because she identified that as an opportunity and said, We just don't want to get them to learn, but we want them to become leaders. And the focus is entirely on leadership development in this program. You should see some of these girls. I've been interacting with them. They come with a very, underprivileged in the society. Their parents are, workers, and they are house help and other things. They speak fluent English. They can converse, they can interact. All their programs, the master of ceremonies are these girls. They don't shy away, but they actually organize a tour for all the senior execs, and generally Chandra comes, and we have few others who come, and they take them around. And the way they interact with them, you would actually be amazed at the level of opportunities that they have taken and made big of it. And the reason I'm highlighting this is that don't be narrow focused on looking at only what we can see. Look at being very inclusive of what are the things which are coming up, and think from that point of view. That's the aspect that I wanted to highlight. Another interesting program, this is what my friend Prashant Girbane, who is the Director General of MCCIA, has been running in his village in near Latur. He's created a very interesting program called Digital Rural Connect. So Prashant actually was from a village, did his engineering in ICT, which was UDCT in those days, went to IIM Ahmedabad, and he was telling me here, whenever I looked at myself, I just couldn't understand what I should do in an urban area. So a person coming from rural India, if you have to live in urban India, what is the type of gap? And he said the gap was phenomenal. I just couldn't imagine that I just didn't know some of the things which were very basic. And when I looked around, all of the other kids were all from urban India. And he said that kept on worrying me, that the divide is so significant, that should we do something to bridge the divide? And he created this concept, which is very interesting. It is called the Digital Rural Connect. So he's used the cyber cafe concept in a very interesting way. So the cyber cafe type of setup is there in his village. It's in the community hall of the village. And the villagers actually run this, and they look at creating connect with people who are in urban areas and get them to talk. So Chief Minister had actually visited this particular center. There are many of my friends and colleagues who just dial in over a Skype or any other mechanism and talk to the people. It's a great opportunity for the people in rural India to get a feel of what is there, what are the type of opportunities are there for them, or are there things for people in urban India to look at what can potentially be done for the people in rural India. So another great opportunity and an example. And the reason I'm highlighting this is a large population of our kids in the engineering colleges are with this background. Are we doing to address that particular aspect? Are we inclusive in our approach on looking at what can potentially be done to address the needs of the rural population? So given this, what we are doing, what are the things which I'm seeing around, and I do these talks at various engineering colleges and various forums, and I tell people that look around. There are a lot many opportunities. Don't get restricted by just looking at a narrow spectrum that you are visible and what is visible to you. So let me talk about what is changing, and this is something which is useful and important for people within the organization. So every organization's workspace is changing, and the type of things which are happening are very interesting. A significant amount of collaboration. So the nature of work, the nature of type of things that we are doing has become very highly collaborative. Collective intelligence is playing a very significant role. The hierarchical model that we have been so used to is sort of disseminating. And one of the best examples that I've always quoted with, if you look at Google, I really admire. They have a very nice quote wherever you go. It says that it is my problem if I can solve it. And they allow people to just nominate themselves and say, I have this particular problem and I can solve this problem. I want to be part of this team. And you can go and self-nominate yourself into that team. Where is the structure? Where is the leader? Where is the organization? So we're seeing these type of things happening quite often within the organizations, and I'm sure many of you would have seen these type of changes happen. We're going through a lot of learning related changes. So a significant amount of effort has gone into transformation of learning itself and how we go about building up the next generation skills. This is something which I've picked up from Professor Sahasrabuddha's talk. He had come here in Pune and he was talking about AICT and different types of skills, and he had picked up this from the World Economic Forum. Again, the type of skills, are we keeping pace with different types of skills? There is a detailed report on the different top skills which are there. What type of opportunities are there for our students? And we have been playing a role in looking at what can be done to help this entire thing. So we have, as a platform, we run an ION platform, which is playing significantly for digital learning and assessment as a process. So lastly, you know, when we look at it, these are things which are more for students, but I'm considering all of us as students given the type of changes which are happening. So what do we do as an individual? How do we change? So one thing which I tell people is just be aware of what's changing and what's really happening around us, and go out, see what is happening. And you know, I've been in this this particular role for about 2 years, and I end up spending at least a week every 2 quarters in Seattle and in the Bay Area, primarily because a lot of innovation happening in the world of cloud, in the world of analytics, in the world of AI is that hub. I'm also going to visit Israel. I spend a lot of time with many of the startups, primarily because it's a great amount of learning for me on what's really happening. And I think that's a very important element that we need to inculcate in all of us. Be a Renaissance person. It's very important for us not just to look at what is relevant to us, but look at what all other things. There are quite a lot of people when we look at around, right? In my organization, when I look at people, they can do multiple things. They can be an artist, they can be a painter, they can do various things. You'd actually be amazed that most engineering colleges in the US now have one particular additional activity, which is a full-fledged program. So I was in the Bay Area about 3 weeks back, and my friend's daughter, she just graduated from Carnegie Mellon, and she's learned to do painting. And she is now taught father and mother also to do that painting on a small A4 size paper. And very interestingly, they have made it a family activity, okay? But the way they look at this is as a element, as things become more and more digitized and things like that, what is the physical aspect of things that people will get in touch with? So people are creating various things, and I believe that's an opportunity for us. There's a lot of data, and you know, not because I run the analytics and insights unit and I preach about data, but data is playing a very crucial role. And I tell people that, you know, have an element of statistics in whatever you do. Stay curious, and the STEM to STEAM is a very interesting area of focus, and I believe that we should look at this. So when we look at internships, why do you have to send people to go and do internships in a TCS or an IT company? Why can't they go and do in a museum? You'll learn about art, you'll learn about culture. It's very important as an empathy element. So don't limit yourself to think in a very narrow spectrum and look at broadening. If this is critical, and this is something which I advocate and I look at people, so whenever I have a team meeting like this, the one question which I ask, how many of you sing? How many of you have other artistic, I ask sports person, how many of you play? I like to look at such diverse set of people as part of my team, because I believe that that's the type of thing which is required. So if that is mainstream, then should we think differently when we look at internships? So why shouldn't somebody go and do an internship in a filmmaking industry? So just a question, just a way of looking at it. And one of my friends, Mahesh Kale, I'm sure you probably know him, very renowned artist and singer. He's an engineer by profession, but a singer. And he's very closely associated with one of the projects that we are doing. And he keeps on telling me that, you know, we definitely need to do something more about encouraging that skills which are there. Most of the times, those skills are left as extracurricular activities, right? Why can't they become mainstream activities? And hence, you can potentially do an internship in that area itself. Just a thought, but it's worthwhile taking a look at it. So creativity is a big thing. You know, I have a colleague, Sunil Karkera, who is running a digital studio in the US in Santa Clara, and they have amazing amount of creative people, and I really amazed by the type of things that they do. Creativity plays a very crucial role in designing newer solutions when you are empathetic towards a particular problem. So here is something which I did in the last 12 months. I've been working very closely with a few people, and we created a publication on the role of data and analytics in social transformation. And the reason why we did this was to actually get that empathy towards understanding what is the problem, how is data playing a very crucial role. And my entire team contributed towards this. We've got a lot of people across the globe. And the reason for doing this was we discovered the entire regime of open data and what public service data is becoming available, which can potentially be used to transform. So that's the type of potential I just wanted to share with you. These are all of these things which I talked to you about are my own experiences. I've been very closely associated with many of these. And I'm sure you'll love to interact and see how you can actually create the same opportunity for the missing customers of today. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for enriching us with the innovative information about the various projects by industries. May I now request Mr. Ajit Tatia to please come for the presidential address.
Good morning, all dignitaries on the dais, of the dais, all friends from industries. It is indeed a great opportunity for me to express on behalf of my organization that you have made a time, make up a time, and have come for the really a good participation for the betterment of the society. Today, this issue was discussed about 2 months back amongst our group, what we can do for our students in association with the industry. And the idea came up and grown up that we should have one big conference along with the industry person so that they can give lights on how our students can go for an internship and how it can help to our students. And now today that dream has come into realization that we are all sitting here discussing about how the future ways could be, would be rather. As Sir Shigal sir has mentioned about internships and IP. Really this IP idea is true for the colleges like IITs and NITs. But engineering colleges like maybe in Nagpur and Pune, where lot of students do come from the rural areas and have their own limitations, ideas, and then really going for an IP, can be a big challenge also. But we accept this challenge unless as we as in college we have set up an IP cell also wherein we invite people from the IP industries and they come and they give guidance and vision to our faculties also, because it has to come to the faculty first and then faculty can give and deliver it to the students. How the IP and intellectual property can be saved and how it can be registered also. And an organization also support to them for going for an IP registration. Then going for training to industry for the teacher is a really very good idea. As a Dysonia organization, we have to think on this and really we can, if we, during the vacation times, if our teachers can go to the industry and understand the subject, topic, delivery, concept, and product development, this will surely will enrich their knowledge and then this will transform, they can transform this knowledge to the students. As long as the industry persons coming and taking these classes, I know that we have started this concept about 2 years back. We invite adjunct faculty from the industry and they do come deliver to the students. What happens is many of the industries, maybe small scale and medium sized industries, they can express their ideas and concept the way they are dealing with the problems. And that's a real life problems which students also know about, and that helps us for developing our students. As Bajaj ma'am mentioned about, there are 15 lakh every year the engineering students are getting graduated. But I was, when sitting on the table, I was just calculating that figure. It is just 0.11% of the total population of India. It's not big number. As an engineer, when he gets passed out, his age is 25 years or 23 years, and he serves till at the age of his 57 years, maybe 30 years, 35 years he serves, which contributes almost 3.5% of the total population. Total number of engineers who pass out at the age of 23 and gets retired at the age of, say, 60 or maybe 57, the total contribution of engineers in the society would be only 3.5%, which is not big number. But why we face this problem today is the pace at which the industry is growing, and the academicians and then academia is giving knowledge to the students, there is a big gap. And therefore, at the end, at the entry level, this hurdle is there. Once the students get entered into the particular job, they progress in a fantastic way. But the entry into an industry, getting job, crackdown and getting a job is really a problem. This is what, because we say, and many of the people say that getting a job is only not only a problem, but it's a problem because of their expectation from the coming engineers are very high versus actual supply of the engineers, how they have been trained. And today's academic syllabuses, or whatever syllabus we have and restricted to the Pune University or SEBI University syllabus, has their own limitations. As Mr. Kolkar sir has mentioned, how fast you can rapidly change, get adapted to the syllabus changes. Being an autonomous institute, we have that leverage, we have that liberty. And we are, you know, dynamic organization. As we, this type of, you know, summit must be done by an organization for the first time in this area. So we are thirsty enough to adapt the things required by the industry and accommodate them for the betterment of the students' education. In this, as Mr. Kolkar sir was mentioning about the art and all these things, I was making a note of this, that during this change, actually, are we really creating a lot of pressure onto students and killing their creativities? We are trying to, you know, merge so many things during their education and their academia 3 or 4 years' time. We try to blend so many things together, and wherein students undergoing a lot of pressures of getting graduated, are we really going to kill the creativity of the students, their intelligence, their leadership? So instead of, you know, rushing behind the internship and his future life, how he would be, so we should nurture their natural intelligence, natural leadership power into an organization. This is what I feel. So this today's whole workshop will give us more light towards how we can support our customers, as mentioned about that. Students should be, we should be focused on centric toward the student, because students are our main customers. That we do really agree to him, and we should plan our activities. And this is also a part of this activity for students to get something out of this. I hope now today's program will put more light and give us some direction. After the discussions, we will conclude on that, and we'll see how we can adapt to it. And Raisoni Group, I must thank to our chairman, Sri Raisoni sir, for, you know, giving a push and thirst that we should do such activities often and keep collaborating with the industry so that we can create a better engineers for the betterment of tomorrow of this country. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your words of wisdom. In order to recognize certain people who stood tall in their stature through their deeds during our two decades of journey with 900 plus industries, we would like to take privilege of honoring such personalities with GHR awards. The awards follow various categories, hence it doesn't follow any sequence. Altogether, we have three sets of awards. Let's commence with the first one. I request Dr. Preeti Bajaj ma'am to please announce the awards.
Thank you, Kaushal. So it's time for first set of GHR awards amongst three. Let's start with the stalwart in the field itself. So I would request our trustee director to do the honor for first award, GHR award for excellence in education, none other than Professor Shegaonkar. Small, sir, let's start with you so that would be there. So Simran. Sir, it's a small award from our side to recognize. And I would also request Tatiya sir to honor. Thank you, sir. And also request Tatiya sir to honor with the another award to Mr. Dinanath Kolkar for GHR Award of Inspirational Global Leadership, and we have just witnessed. Congratulations, and thank you for a great insight which we could have from rural to global. You have covered the whole journey. Thank you so much. We have our other mentors as well, and those who have been associated with us in since long. And I will request Professor Shegaonkar sir, our chief guest of today, to do the honors for the awards of first sets, rest of the awardees. Mr. Sanjay Nivande, ARAI, Deputy Director, GHR Awards with Industry Pattern. So, he was earlier associated with Mahindra & Mahindra. We have Mahindra & Mahindra's lab as well. Right now, he's doing great job being operational head of homology and technology center at Chakan. He has worked earlier with Mahindra & Mahindra as DGM, proto development, R&D, Nasik and MRV. He is chairman Western Region of SAE. He helped to establish Mahindra & Mahindra lab. He's always been supportive for students, and he just spoke about he's very much instrumental in organizing competition as Baha. Congratulations, Sanjay Nivande sir. Next award is to Director Asia Technical Center, Cummins Filtration, Mr. Prashant Vani. This is the GHR award for safety in operation. Sir. So, Mr. Prashant Vani, Director, Asia Technical Center, GHR Award for Safety in Operation. Mr. Vani is leading global product design and developments for filtration business for Cummins Inclusive, which focuses on products like loop, fuel filters, air cleaners, bithers, etc. He is developing India Technical Center, which is going to be Cummins' biggest technical center. He has 23 years of experience in various domains like Six Sigma, coach and mentor team, and design of various systems. Congratulations, Mr. Vani. Next is to Bani Hazra, and this is for scientist F for DRDO, GHR Award for Industry Mentor, Public Sector. She has dynamic work experience in design and development of defense system. She has total work experience of 23 years plus. She has also received Agni Award for Excellence in Self-Reliance. Congratulations, Bani ma'am. Next award is to GHR Award for Excellence in Operations. This is to Barnali Sen Gupta from Endurance, and I invite, yes ma'am, congratulations for GHR Awards for Excellence in Operation. This is human resource professionals having experience in developing, implementing HR strategies throughout various performance management, talent acquisition, HR policies, human resource planning, and industrial employee relation. Heartiest congratulations. Next award for GHR Award for Sustainable Mobility is to Manikandan as General Manager, Fiat India Automobiles Private Limited. Congratulations, sir. Sir is involved in product development of Jeep Crystaller vehicles and achieved 50% of non-conference reduction by closely involved with supplier in resolving the assembly issues. Winner of award of Managing Director of Cummins for category innovation for the year 2005 for development of resistance brazing process. Heartiest congratulations. Next award is for green energy, and this is to Shrikant More, GE India Private Limited for wind energy division. Mr. Shrikant More, congratulations. He is HR associate with GE, worked with TVS group, involved in performance appraisal of HR policies, new hiring operations and orientation. So Mr. More, next to Vice President HR, Baliram Mutagikar, sir, GH Award for Social Leadership. Congratulations. Mr. Baliram Mutagikar, he is VP HR for Analytics and working, having 17 years of experience in HR management, effectively handled code HR of 3,500 employee plus employees, successfully hired 5,000 plus quality resource with excellence hit ratio. Next award is to GHR Award for Innovative Practices in Manufacturing, none other than Arun Advekar sir for Kirloskar Pneumatics Company Limited, Associate Vice President, a senior leader with 35 years of industry experience in the field of quality assurance, operations, supply management, management system and deployment of business excellence in diverse sectors like precision engineering, auto ancillary, automotive engines and heavy engineering in reputed organizations. A passionate, committed, creative individual with high ethical standards, integrity. Next award is to GHR Awards for Excellence in Design for Prashant Mayamkar, LG Electronics Private Limited. This, he is General Manager, Head SCM, EMS and Export. Heartiest congratulations. He has 2 decades of experience in establishing and managing supply chain function, extensive experience in international sales, product promotion and marketing, experience in ISO audit, LG global capability audit and process audit. This completes our first set of awards. Let's join for high tea. Thank you so much for everyone. So with this, we declare inaugural program to be over. Let's have some networking for just 10 minutes for tea break. We are lagging behind the schedule. So we'll assemble after 10 minutes over here. Thank you.